on Tuesday. So we've covered three classes, and you can get the recordings for those three classes from the counselor. Just ask them and they'll send you the links.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So do you have a Linux system set up for practice?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, good. So now throughout this course, we'll be working on different kinds of CTFs. So have you worked on a CTF previously? Like, have you tried solving a CTF in the past?
No, sir.
No. Okay. So see, what CTFs are, basically there are challenges that you have to solve. It's like a, you could say it's like a puzzle, but related to hacking. Now, the first one that we're working on, actually technically is the second one that we're working on, that is known as basic pen testing. So it's a virtual machine that you can download, and I'll just send you the link in a moment. I'll mention it in the chat and take it from there. And you set up that VM on your system.
Yeah.
And we'll be working on trying to hack into it. Let me just get that link. So I've pasted it in the chat. You can get it from there. You can download it from there. So now we had started working on this one. So I'll just give you a small recap of what we've done so far. Let me just get that one up and running, and I'll start. Okay, so the first thing we did was we tried to find out the IP address of that machine. Now, again, the steps to do that, all of that is in the previous sessions.
Record permission.
Okay, pardon?
It's a recording permission access.
Recording permission, actually, I'm recording it on my end. So the first thing we did was we figured out the IP address. The steps for that, when you look at the previous class recordings, they'll be easy to figure out. We used a tool known as Net Discover. Okay, all the exact steps, look at the recordings for that. Otherwise, what you can do is you can use Nmap and perform a ping sweep of your network. So whatever devices are up, you will get a response. So it's showing me the responses for four devices. Now this one, this particular device is our own system, and if so, you can even confirm that this is the IP that is assigned to my device. This is the IP for the gateway, and this is also for the gateway, is just another interface. So that leaves us with one more IP, which is our target. So we did an nmap scan. So a quick scan shows us that there are three ports open, 21, 22, and 80. Now I can do an in-depth scan, or just a slightly more in-depth scan to figure out if there are other ports open. So I scan for all ports. No, just three ports even again. So now I can run other scans like script scans and vulnerability scans, but they're not going to be very effective in this case. Okay, so we have figured out that there is port 80 which is open and an HTTP server is running on this port. Okay, so whenever there is an HTTP server running, how can we access it? You can access it through your browser, because an HTTP server means a website, a web server. Okay, so we got a web server, but this is not really the path to a website. So we need to figure out the path for where the website might be hosted. So for that, we use what is known as a directory brute forcing tool, which tries to figure out what directories or what files are available on a website. So we use dub for that, which is just short for directory buster. Now we're not technically using brute force, it's just a dictionary attack, but still it's known as directory brute forcing. Okay. So it has found one directory for us, which is secret, and visit this path. So we're getting a website. Now the thing is, okay, when I click this link, notice that the IP here will change to something known as VTCSEC. Now, normally this would give you an error, but what we did was, okay, I'm just going to stop this. We edited the hosts file on the system, which contains mappings from IP addresses to domain names or hosts. So we added this VTCSEC. We associated that with this IP. See, if I remove this, what will happen? Take a look. I'm going to save it. And if this is not there, then see what is going to happen. If I try to load this, okay, currently I think it's just cached. Or I think the entry is still within the cache, so that's why it's working. Is working right now. Let me use Okay, so see, when we access this IP and this secret path, so we get something like this, which looks like a very badly formatted web page. Now, if I click on this, it tries to go to something known as VTCSEC. Now, this is not a valid domain over the internet, so a DNS query for this is not going to work. So all these links point to a website or point to a host known as VTCSEC, But our system does not know what VTC sec is. We know that it's going to be this IP itself. So we can create a mapping in the host file. Now, before your system sends out a DNS query for a host or a domain, it checks this host file. If it finds that, then it's going to use the value for whatever value is associated with it. Now, if I try this again, let's see. So now it works properly because it knows where to get the images from, where to get the files from. So it's properly formatted. It works. Close this, going back here. Now this is a WordPress website. Okay, so now we'll move forward from this part today. So this is a WordPress website. Let's try scanning this website and see what we can find. So one of the scanners that I can run is Nikto. And I need to provide it the complete path. Now this can take a while to complete, but so far it is not showing us any information that we can actually use to hack into it. I'm just going to go over to the next terminal and I will be running another scanner, which is WP scan. Now this is built solely for WordPress websites. So the only kind of websites this is going to work on are websites that use WordPress. For anything else, it's not going to work. So the usage is WordPress, WP scan, URL or U, and again our same URL. I can simply do this and let it perform the scan. Okay, sorry, you have to write URL here. U does not work in this case.
So my calling message aborted. Suddenly something it was not responding. I closed and now it is showing aborted.
Aborted?
Yeah.
So that happens if there is an error and it shuts down or it crashes. So then the state turns to aborted. Try booting it up once again. Try booting it up. If it does not work, then we'll look into it. Otherwise, see. So even this Nikto, it finds this secret path and it figures out that a WordPress installation is present. And directory indexing found. Okay, so you can see the uploads for this website. Unless we can upload something, this is not very useful to us. And there's also a WordPress login found. So WordPress login page is accessible to us. And we can log in. Let's take a look at what the other scanner has for us. So WP scan, this is specifically for WordPress websites. Okay. Nothing really interesting here. We haven't really checked for the robots.txt file. Okay, it does not exist on this server. Okay. Now with the WP scan, if I take a look at the options, see, I want to figure out whether I'll be able to log in as the admin, because that would be really helpful. If you're able to log in as the admin, then we could make changes to the website. So let's see. Okay, let's first try to find out. There is one post here. Which user has made this post? By admin. Okay, so the admin user has made this post. So we know that there is at least one account here, and it is called admin, and the name suggests that it is the administrator account for this website. So what we can do is we can try to log in, and since they have kept the default username of admin, maybe we can try out some default passwords. So let's see if the word password itself works. Okay, not working. Password you entered for the username admin is incorrect. So that means the username admin exists, but the password is wrong. Okay, let's try pass, or maybe ABC123. Or even the word admin itself. It looks like this is indeed the correct password. Okay, so again, the issue here is weak passwords. The credentials for this admin account were simply the words admin, admin, same username and password. So now we have access to this entire admin panel for this website. And if I want, I can make changes to the content of the website itself. So can anyone tell me what can I use here? To try and get terminal access, to try and get a shell on this system with the help of this admin panel access that we have just got, we have just been able to obtain. Now, whenever you are trying to hack onto a system, your first task or your focus would be to get some kind of shell access on that system. So shell access would mean you're able to use the terminal, you're able to use the command line on that system, because that allows you to have control over the system. You can search for files, you can upload stuff, download stuff, and that basically helps you do anything you want on the system. And after you get shell access, you try to perform privilege escalation. So from a normal user account, you want to get access, you want to get the account of the root. If you're talking about Linux, you want to get access to the root account, if you're talking about Windows, you want to get the administrator account access. So for that, you'll have to perform privilege escalation. Okay, we'll come to that in a while. But the first thing here is to get this.
Some kind of injection will work here.
Pardon?
Some kind of injection will work here.
Injection, like, not really, actually, you know, injection is not something that we'll make use of. Injection is when you're trying to just exploit something within the web application itself. Like you're trying to get one of the application's inputs and you're trying to behave it in such a way so as to get some information from it. So it could be SQL injection, of course, it could be template injection. But again, that is not what we are going to do here. We are admin already here. Okay, so that means, see, injection does not really give you complete control over a site. We are at a level that we don't really need to perform any kind of injection. We already have complete control over the website. Now, all I need to do is leverage that control to be able to get a terminal on the web server itself. So for that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to Appearance Editor. So now WordPress has different themes and different page templates for every page that you see. So there is something known as single post. So this is the template that WordPress uses in order to display every single post. So that means if I click on this, that means I'm viewing a single post and it is following that template. So that template is written in PHP and this is the complete thing. What I'm going to use here is I'm going to replace this code with the code for a PHP reverse shell. So when that code runs, it will try to perform a reverse connection to my system and I will be getting a reverse shell on my target, which is our web server. So for the reverse shell, there is a very popular PHP reverse shell. Reverse PHP shell or PHP reverse shell, if you Google it, there is this very popular PHP reverse shell code by Pentest Monkey on GitHub. So you can get this. This is the PHP file. Okay, so what we need to do is we just need to select this, not the entire thing. And I need to replace the code on that page with this PHP code. So I've replaced it. Now there is a couple of parameters that I need to change. The IP and the port for this reverse shell to work. Now with the IP, what IP do I need to put here?
Current IP.
My IP, so
yeah.
So the IP for my Kali system, right? That's what you're saying?
Yes, yes.
Okay, good. That is correct. And port can be whatever you want. Okay, so port is not really, there's no rules here. But just make sure that you don't use a well-known port which might be in use by a service or a process on your system. So use something random like, okay, 7777. And IP, again, I'm going to specify my own IP. 10.0.2.15, which is the IP for my attacking Linux system. So when this code runs, it will try to create a reverse shell to this IP on this port that we've given it. So let's update file to save our changes. And okay, now when I reload this, that template should work. But before that, I need to do something. What is that? Can anyone tell me?
We need to view that whatever happening on that site. So we need to connect that.
We need to run that code. That is fine. But on my system, what do I need to do?
Yeah, we need to observe, right? So, some command is that which will allow us to see what is happening over there.
Observe, I'm not really getting. To see what is happening over there, like on that system, on the target. I'm not sure how we do that. But see, what I mean here is that when you are trying to get a reverse connection, you need to have something open on your system to catch that reverse connection. Now, I've mentioned in my reverse PHP code that I want it to connect to this IP on this port. But I have to make sure that I'm ready to receive a connection on that port. So for that, I'm going to be using something known as netcat, which you can use by NC. And I'm going to specify a couple of options. One is -L, which tells netcat that we are going to be listening on a port. Listening means you open up a port and put it in the listening state. In listening state, a port is going to wait for any incoming connections. I'm going to make it.
Sir, in ECH course, we did something like when we used reverse binding, port reversing, something is there. So in that, we did like this only, like what you are telling, listening. So that I was telling, like, I don't remember exactly.
Okay. So listening is what we do. Listening is, you're not doing listening on the other system. That is something you're doing on your system.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So listening is simply, you're opening up a port on your system and you're trying to have it ready to receive an incoming connection. That is what you're trying to do. So -L tells netcat that we want to listen and not connect to another port. We want to open a port for listening. -V tells us that, tells netcat that I want to make my output verbose. And another thing is P. So P is followed by the port number on which I want to listen. So the port number is the same which I specified there, which is 7777. Press enter. And it says that it is listening on any. So for any protocol, TCP, UDP, it is listening on port 7777. Now let's try executing this code by getting this template to run, which is a template for a single post in WordPress. So this is a single post. And let's try to run the thing that we have. It is not running. Because we're not receiving any connections. Let me open it up again. Let me just check something that this is fine. After making this IP address, do you save it? Okay. It's not executing it for some reason. Let me check. We copied the entire thing. Oh, we missed out this last. It should work now. So see, even a little, just one symbol can ruin your entire code. And we've received an incoming connection now. So just connect to this IP, which is our own machine's IP from VTCsec. So we've received an incoming connection. And it has run a couple of commands for us. The ID command, so it tells us that currently we're not logged in as any user, but we are logged in as this www data service. Okay, so now the first thing that I need to do is get a proper shell. So I can do that with the help of Python and hyphen c, because we want to execute this code in the command line itself. Import pty, so it's a Python library. And we wanted to spawn a shell for us, just bin bash. So now we have a much better shell, which we got Python to spawn. So we used Python hyphen c that we want to execute this command in the, that we specify in the line itself. We are importing a Python library and using that to spawn a shell. Now in Linux, the main shell is this bin bash shell that we use. So this is the shell. If I do who am I? I'm currently logged in as this service www data. I don't have user privileges. I don't even, there is no way that I have root privileges. I'm not even a user currently. So however, I have shell access to the system now. So any suggestions as to how should I proceed with trying to get access as a...
We can try SU. So can we try SU?
SU, but for SU you would need to know the password for the some user. We currently don't know any passwords.
But in that site we tried with admin and okay, that is site one.
But that is for the website. If I try to see how many users are there? Okay, so in that case, we had a user named admin and password was admin as well, but that was only for the website. Now, okay, there is one user known as Marlin Spike. Doesn't look like there is anyone else here. Apart from root, there is just one user which we can observe, which is Marlin Spike. So there's, and we don't know the password for this person.
Sir, how we are identifying that is a user?
Okay, look at all the other accounts. There are two ways that you can do this. Now, user accounts usually have permissions. Sorry, not permissions, IDs. Which start from 1000, and if I add another user on the system, the next ID would be used, which is 1001. All these system services have IDs ranging from 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, but user accounts, their user IDs and group IDs, which are these two values. The first value is user ID, second is group ID. So the user ID start from 1000. That is one way. And another way to figure out whether it's a user or a system service is that this last section, okay, take a look at this last section as well as this second last section. So in the last section, this bin bash that you see, this is the kind of user has access to. So that is mentioned here. In other cases, it's either user system binary no login. That means these services are not allowed to log in on the system, or they don't really have shell access, or it's bin false. So that means these are not user accounts. And there is actually one more thing that you can now check. Which is the home account, sorry, the home directory. There is a directory called home, and it contains the home directories for every user who is present on the system. So for Marlin Spike, you can see the home directory that is mentioned is under this home, and the name of the home directory is the same as the username itself. There is no other entry here. There is no other entry which has any directory with under home. So if you consider all these different things, that will point you to the conclusion that there is only one user, and of course there is a root account. So root account is going to be there anyway, and there is one other user. So this is the password file, which does not actually contain the passwords anymore. So what file does contain the passwords? Do you guys remember?
Shadow.
Yes, shadow. Will we be able to see the shadow file from here? Would that be possible? What do you think?
No, that requires root access.
That requires root access. That is true. And shadow is also within the etc directory. Let me just check something. This is interesting. Look at the permissions for the shadow file. We have read permission on this file, so this is not properly configured on the system. So let me try to access it. And we're able to see the contents of this shadow file. Now, for this Marlin Spike user, I can see that this is the password hash for him. What I can do is I can copy this. I'll just copy this. I'll switch over to a different terminal on my own system. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to create a file. Let's just say Marlin, just name it Marlin. Paste this, exit, save it. And we can attempt to crack this password. Now with password cracking, there is never any guarantees that you'll be able to find it. But we can at least try. So what tool can I use for this purpose? There are a couple of tools, John the Ripper and Hashcat. Okay, so I actually prefer John because it's a very good tool. John, the syntax to use John the Ripper in this case is simply I can say John and I can give it the name of the file. So in this case, it will do some of its own attacks and try to figure out if it can crack the password. Apparently, it has already cracked it. So you see, it even identifies the hash all on its own. I don't even need to tell it what kind of hash is present. I could also have used a dictionary attack, but okay, we didn't require it here. Now, if you want to see the results, you can view them properly using the show command. Okay, so Marlinspike, which means the credentials for this account are Marlinspike and Marlinspike. That's it. So it's the same thing. So this person has used admin on the website and Marlinspike on the system. So now I can try to log in as this user. As you can see, we are now logged in as Marlinspike. So now we have the privileges of this user. Any privilege he has, we also have that. Because we are, of course, logged in as this user. So whatever files Marlinspike can access, we can take a look. Now it's a good idea to look into the home directory of this user. And like I mentioned, within home, you will see all the user directories. So there's just one, because there's only one user other than root. And that user is known as Marlinspike. So I can try to cd into his directory, see if I find something. Okay, backdoor pro ftpd 1.3.3c. actually the pro ftpd server that is running, it is also vulnerable and can be exploited using Metasploit. Let me just open up Metasploit in another window, in another terminal alignment. And these are the contents of this user's directory. There are a lot of files here, but there is actually nothing that is going to help us. We'll go back. Okay. Just change to the main directory and perform -l here. Now again, this machine has not been configured like a typical CTF, so there are no flags here that we can get. Otherwise, what happens is typically there is a flag in the user's home directory and the root flag is in the root directory. So this directory is what I'm talking about. And you can see only the root account has permissions. No one else can do anything there. So as Marlinspike, I currently cannot get inside the root directory. My ultimate goal on the system is to get root access. Now this process, like I mentioned, it's known as privilege escalation. And there are multiple ways of getting privilege escalation. Now, whenever you log into a system and you have the password for the account that you're using, it can help to run sudo with a specific flag known as sudo hyphen L. This command is going to tell you whether this person can use sudo on the system or not. and you need to enter the password first. So Marlin Spike itself is the password. Okay, pay attention to this part. It says user Marlin Spike may run the following commands on VTCSec. All. Okay, so basically user Marlin Spike can use sudo, and using sudo he can run whatever commands he wants on that system. So now can you give me an idea of how I can get access to root account, or how I can get a shell using root based on what we have done on this system and what we've seen so far?
We crack Marlin Spike's similarly root, we can crack with the password
file. Root password is not present in the shadow file if you look at
yeah.
it.
Yes, sir.
It's not present there. But we don't need to crack it. See, what we do is, now technically you could say that you don't even need the user account. Why? Because you can run anything you want as sudo using this Marlin Spike's account. So technically sudo isn't even required, but however, since that is what we have to do. Now if you remember, I ran a command as soon as I got shell access. The first command I ran was a Python command which I used to get an upgraded shell on the system. If I use that with sudo, I can simply get a better shell. Sudo I can log in as root through this method, basically, because we are using sudo. So this is going to run as root. Now when it runs at as root and gives us a shell, it will be a root shell. So see, when I root, now I can easily access the root directory. Now, there is nothing in the root directory, but in other CTFs that you will see, the root directory will have a file known as root.txt, which will contain your flag. So the ultimate goal with any CTF is to get root access onto your system, onto your target system. Once you have that, that means you will have complete control over the system and you will be able to do whatever you want. So the process of escalating your privileges from a normal user to that of a root account is known as privilege escalation. So that is it for this machine. Now, like I mentioned, there is another way to do this via Metasploit, which is known as the easy way. But it's not that fun, if you ask me. Okay, we already have Metasploit. Search and the FTP server that is running, ProFTPD. Now, there's quite a few versions. This is the one that's running on our target system. Can verify this with a quick nmap scan. you can see this is the version that's running, Pro FTPD 1.3.3c. Now I didn't really want to focus on just using Metasploit, so I kept this for the end. In a real pen test, of course, Metasploit is your friend, but when you are learning, it's better to do things without Metasploit. Use, and I can simply use the fourth result, or the fifth result actually, which is number four. Use four. Show options. I need to set the R hosts. Okay, we can select a payload.
So not can I that payload in?
CMD Unix generic. I usually use reverse, but I'm just on a whim, I use generic this time. Let's see what happens. So generic, okay. Generic is not really useful here. I'll just run it with, I forgot to specify payload options, L host. Now if I run this, so the exploit is successful and command shell has been opened for my root. We received a command shell. Let's see whether we can upgrade it to a Metapretor shell or not. Okay, so we have.
So for this, you have me press enter or automatically came that prompt?
I pressed enter once. I had to press it once, otherwise okay. It couldn't appear. I want to interact with the session 2, which is a Metapretor shell. So we now with the Metapretor shell on our target system. And for a list of all the commands that you can run, type help. So these are some basic file system commands. You have your core commands like running the process in the background. Okay. Then you have file system commands. So upload or download files or delete files. Then you have networking commands, so you can get the interface details, network interface details for your target. Then you can execute a system command, you can run and list the running processes. From Metapretor, if you want to go into a system shell, you can do that via the shell command. You can get system information with sysinfo. You can even get access to the webcam if there is one connected to the VM, or to the target system. Same thing goes for mic. You can also play audio on the target. Now again, this is not going to work in all situations, but in some cases it might work. Because if there is no webcam attached or if there's no match, then this is not going to work.
So can I run any one command from this?
From this, okay. Like let's say we run sysinfo. So it gives you some information about the system. We can use ps to list the running processes. So ps. So these are the running processes on the target system. You can
there's something play something, so we should know some files and all, right, to play them.
This is play a file that is on your own system, play that on the target system.
So we should know.
No, you should not know this kind of file on the target. If you have an audio file on your system, you can play that on the target using this.
Okay,
so the file your system, but you can play that on the target. So again, you can view the interface details as well. Let me just write this and get the menu again. You can view the ARP cache for the host system. Host as in your target host. You can kill processes if you want. You can shut down services on that system. You can download a file from that system. You can upload a file to that system. Okay, basically, you can just change whatever files you want, do whatever you want with them. You can execute kill command, kill running services, get information. So MeetupRouter allows you quite a lot of things and also provides you with a lot of information. But again, privilege escalation is something that you'll have to do on your own if you are not able to get a MeetupRouter. If you are not able to access the system as root. Okay, so I'm exiting this currently. So there were two different ways to hack this system. One was through Metasploit and the other was through the website did. So that is the end of this particular CTF machine, or this VM, whatever you want to call it. And the next one that we'll be doing, I'll give you the link for that as well.
Sir, how did you know that, like, we have to go in that website, we have to go to that
the website
and we have to you have selected from the display or something.
See, to the website, we just had three open ports. Okay.
Yeah.
So when we ran our initial scan, we just had three open ports. One of them was SSH. Now, SSH is used to log into a system remotely. But in order to log in, you need to have some credentials. Without credentials, you cannot log in. So SSH is out of the question when you're starting. FTP, okay, now admit we could have tried this in the beginning. Actually, I did try this yesterday. I tried to do an anonymous login via FTP. and we saw that it did not work. Now, of course, using Metasploit, we can hack it, but Metasploit just makes it very easy. We don't get to, do a lot of stuff ourselves. Metasploit just automates a lot of things. So that's why I didn't want to go the Metasploit way while hacking this. So if you leave out these two options, you are only left with HTTP. HTTP means web server. So it means there is a website that you can access through your browser. And that is what we did. So clear now?
Yes, sir, please go to that website.
This web, the one that we...
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay. This is still... This one?
Yes, sir. Also, there were many options when you clicked on, when you logged into admin. You have selected particular thing like...
After logging in, okay.
Logging.
Okay, here.
Yeah, how did you come to know that you have to go into the appearance only, then you have to select that?
How do we know that? Okay, just a little bit of Googling will help you. What to Google, okay. So in this case, first think of what you want to do. You want to make changes to a template which is being used by WordPress. Okay. What we want to do is we are making changes to a WordPress template which is being used by default. So you can use something along the lines of changing a WordPress template or modifying a theme in WordPress. And through that, you can go ahead and do this. But I just showed you this way. Now, mostly what you do is in such situations, you can use Google to figure out this stuff. But this is just a quick way that I showed you that you can go to appearance and editor and change the stuff. Because WordPress websites are very... it's very likely that you'll run into a WordPress website in a CTF or even in a pen test. WordPress is very common. So that's just one way I showed you that you can go about changing these themes and inserting your own custom code, whatever you want, to a website, into a WordPress website specifically.
So please go to that appearance. Here, little yes. Bit.
Okay.
I did not understand. Then you went to editor, right?
Editor, okay. Yes.
Okay, okay.
So should I go to editor?
Yeah.
Okay. So the theme that is being used is known as 2017. So that's just the name of our theme.
So how did you understand this is for when we click on that hello one? So it will go
okay.
To this only.
Okay. Okay, I'll tell you. So in the right hand side, if you'll take a look at this column,
yeah.
It says theme files. So these are some files for this particular theme, and these are basically templates.
Okay,
so you see there's a template for 404, so which means the error page you get when you type an incorrect address. We could have used this as well. Okay, that this is also an option. archive.php. So for this particular link, we could have used it for comments.php. So when you render the comments on a page, this is the template being used. This is a PHP code that is used there. But I preferred to use this single post because it is very easy to get to. You just change it, just click on the title of that post and you open it. I had another option, which was to use the main index template. So in that case, what we could do is we could as soon as we access the main page, like VTCSec secret, then our code would have run if I changed this template. But let's avoid changing the main page of the website itself if we can. So that's why I use this. You can also use the search results page, try searching something on the website. So insert your code here. There are multiple options. There is no fixed rule that you have to use a single post, you know, something, but this is easy to get to. So I just use this. This is completely up to you.
Okay. Instead of editor also, we can use any other thing if in this, right?
Other than editor, actually, for this particular getting a reverse shell, you can't use anything other than the editor.
Okay.
I mean, there is another option with Metasploit. Then you have to upload a file and then you get shell access. But I don't really want to focus too much on Metasploit. That's why I'm not covering that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anything else?
Nothing.
Okay. So I would recommend all of you do practice this on your own as well, whatever we are covering in class. So that whatever we are seeing here, you'll also get a little bit of hands-on practice with it, and that will help you build up some confidence as well. So definitely do practice this. And I was talking about the next machine. Have I posted the link for that? I don't think I have.
No, sir.
No. Okay, let me just paste it. Okay, in the chat I've mentioned.
Yes, sir, it's there. Yes.
Yeah, I just pasted it. So, this is the next one that we'll be targeting. And again, this is something we'll install similarly to this basic pen testing one. Just go to this link, download it. Now, don't worry, after this, everything will be web based. So, I'm not going to get you to install more systems. Not eating up any more space after this. And okay, so again, from the next session onwards, I will be targeting this particular machine. Now, this is actually based.